Hey there! One of my favorite aspects of character design is that in addition to the typical set of skills and things to keep in mind that you deal with drawing anything, there's also an amount of engineering to be done. It's almost like a puzzle, but not one that was made by someone else that has a definitive answer. It's uncharted territory. Too often a term like being creative is referred to as a means of emotional expression, which isn't untrue in character design and illustration, but a lot of the fun also comes with the struggle, frustration, and eventual solutions that come from being creative doing this problem solving. It's something that I'm really passionate about, and I want to show you a few of my problems and solutions from my art this past month, and pass on, hopefully, a few practical things that can help you. Really quickly, this Thursday, we'll have an extra video for this week made in collaboration with my wife, Tay, who's releasing her book, Writing Complete Characters, on August 31st this month. Make sure to come by for the new video on Thursday, and you can pre-order her book now at an introductory rate at brookseggleston.com/shop. I thought we could start with a character that we left off with in the previous video along these lines. That's with the story-weaving bard Enyo, a tall, lanky, bird-like character that's shrouded in a bit of mystery. My goal was to start with the existing character and end with something adjacent to a chibi-fied version of him, like this timekeeper that I'd done before. This has almost been a therapeutic process for me in the past, because I'm starting with a character I've already designed and I'm aware of the shapes of. I've already solved their problem, and I'm merely simplifying them down a bit more. It wasn't so cut and dry with this particular character for a few reasons. For one, as we've established in the past, the chibi style proportionally comes down to a character that is about 2 or 2.5 heads tall. That means that their body needs to basically be as tall as their head. With a character like Enyo, there's two problems with that. For one, he's incredibly tall and lanky, and second, his head is super long, but not tall, like it would be with a human. His mask is also not strictly part of his head, but sizing it up would make it almost ridiculously large. So something somewhere has to give, and it's not as easy as what I did initially, which was play around with just the existing size of each of his limbs. So that strict formula would not work in his case. Instead, I essentially treated all of the area around his upper body, where his clothing and head is, as that head region, instead of just the head by itself, and everything below that as something to match that same height, or the second head tall, so to speak. That made it so that the pose that I was hoping for him to be in, playing the flute, would be manageable in this style. I think that's a really key thing to keep in mind with problem solving, is that oftentimes there's rules that you have put into place in your own head that are often arbitrary and don't matter, that are keeping you from reaching the end goal that you're hoping for. The next problem solving is a little bit more general and includes a few different things. So the front runner for this illustration is the singing guinea pig that headlines the Shackleton prison band in the game that we're working on called Shackleton. Previously, when the game was going to be made in 3D, I had built a 3D sculpt of the character. We've changed directions now where it's a 2D illustrated style though, and it's been a while since I did something with this band. You can see a very old version of them on screen here on the left, and something that tends to happen, at least with me, is the early iterations of something like an animal character might skew toward realistic, because it's heavily based on the reference, the shapes from the reference. I'm still kind of internalizing the idea of the creature, and I'm still getting a feel for their shapes. The sloth, bird, and flute-playing animals in that early version are clearly very clunky though, so in updating or doing a retake on these characters, it was almost like simplifying and exaggerating, basically from scratch. Something that was very important to get across, especially from that original, was a sense of melancholy and wistful sadness just built straight into their design. These are not characters that are momentarily sad, they have been indefinitely locked up and use their music as a source of catharsis and hope for the other prisoners around them. For the guinea pig, she's like a young child, like a falling piece of delicate china. So the sense of sadness is the kind that you'd see in a child, a sort of, what? That's not fair, of betrayal. It feels recent. The sloth has the kind of sadness that a timid personality would have. It's similar to the child's, but it's a little more resigned or even scared. And then the bird is meant to be an old soul who has been through this so long that you can read in its face that it's basically all it's ever known. And then the echidna is perhaps not so explicitly sad, but there's a sense of withdrawn stoicism. So there's some sadness there. Hope you enjoy it. I think the problem solving here comes from really pushing the shapes and personalities of your characters, that it's more readily apparent what their overall disposition is, or what we're supposed to understand about them, even from a sort of neutral expression. I think with all of these, there's an even further place you could push, a further extreme, to get an even sadder or more explicit sense of sadness from them, but just at zero, so to speak, you can still read that. Hopefully Mark and I will have more to share with you about our game soon. We have not stopped working on it, and we can't wait to show you. A quick interlude here for a design that has no problems, because the Velocipaca is perfect in every way. In all seriousness though, this may seem like a small thing, but even in instances where here I'm trying a different solution for the feet, different shapes or ideas, it's kind of like a game that you're playing either with the original designer or especially with your past self. You're taking the entirety of this old idea, all the work that went into it, in this case, something years old that I've definitely improved in my art since, kind of flattening the layers of the whole design process from before and saying, can I do better than this? And sometimes you get kind of contrarian with yourself and say, well, I have to change the design because I must be inherently better equipped now to solve it than I was then. But it's not always so simple. Sometimes the best thing that you can do is respect the thought and choices that went into something before, and maybe just apply your now superior drawing or draftsmanship knowledge to the old design. A few facts about the Velocipaca: they aren't sheared for their wool, they're sheared to be more aerodynamic, and the creators of Jurassic Park might be interested to hear that they're closer in size to the Deinonychus than the Velociraptor. Our last problem-solving session in earnest is kind of an object lesson in balancing between accuracy and what the illustration calls for. We're constantly struggling between the two points of what's absolutely correct, like say the proportions of limbs, but also what is subjectively right, or good-looking, or appealing, which can be skewed and altered and adjusted for a 2D image. Kind of like how your hair doesn't need to look good in all directions for a video call, it just needs to look good from the front. In this case, there were a few mistakes I ended up making in the process, where I got kind of lost in the woods, caring too much about avoiding tangents in this illustration, overlapping ideas that would get confusing, to a point where it actually broke the overall image in a few ways. For example, I got so focused on making it so that Koji's legs weren't overlapping each other in the image that I accidentally made an adjustment to the far leg that made it like a full segment longer. Fortunately, some feedback and help from Nick and John, who have either been on or we've talked about on the channel before, gave some really life-saving help on that, and some cloth and lighting treatments as well. This is an illustration that I really like the final colors of, and while you only get a portion of it on this month's trading card, I'd really love to offer it as like a full print at some point, just because there's so much more of it outside of that crop. I think as something that can be helpful to avoid this problem with the leg, and again the neck of the banjo overlapping with the back of the pangolin, is to recheck the overall silhouette of your design or illustration, but also create flat silhouettes for each individual piece of your character and see if it's still clear from just that flat read. I think with any kind of problem solving, the ability or the skills to problem solve are going to be more valuable than the solution or just being given the solution, but especially when it's something with art or design or the purpose being different every single time you go to make something, it's helpful to be, you know, have lateral thinking, be able to think outside the box, and not get too attached to certain sets of rules that you assign to yourself arbitrarily. You can get all of the art that you saw in this video in this month's Biko's Backpack. If you want, you can go over to patreon.com/bageldenizen and choose the Biko's Backpack tier to have a new package of original art, all made by me, arrive in your mailbox every month. Also, the Learn Character Design course, which I've recently re-released, is out. at learncharacterdesign.com. It's a comprehensive character design curriculum. You can start even without any kind of prior drawing knowledge, because we build on the drawing, story, and design fundamentals to get you creating characters that people care about. We'll see you Thursday for today's extra video. Thank you so much for watching, and have fun creating.